even though I'm sitting in my office, and I'm extremely frustrated not to be with you this morning, not to be able to see you, so I'm just watching a camera, which doesn't look as good as you are all look. So, sorry about that, sorry not to be with you today. I did a 3-hour trip yesterday, but just to go a few miles away from the office, stuck in traffic. Listen, I'm glad to address you this morning to talk about the global tax challenges. And I understand I've been allocated 3 hours to talk about tax challenges, but I will try to cut it in 10 to 15 minutes and not to bother you too much. We are at a juncture, as you all know, and I think it's good to step down a bit and try to understand why we are at this juncture. To start with, international tax, or let's put it otherwise, tax has never been that high on the international political agenda. I think it's never been very high on the international political agenda, and it is now. We are all accustomed to tax being high on the national agenda because of the fiscal constraints, of the monetary constraints. The tax instrument has been more used than ever. But that has not been the case for international tax, for a simple reason, which was that this was left to technicians, this was marginal, this was just about limiting the frictions between tax sovereignties, and no more than that, not really political. What has happened which has made this issue of international cooperation that high on the political agenda? And of course, the answer is known by everybody. That's the financial crisis. But how come can we make this connection between the financial crisis and this tax agenda, which has been taken over by the G20, which has been taken over by the OECD? And now you can see that the crowd is enlarging. I mean, the IMF is moving on this territory. The UN has always been there, but is increasing its work. Not to mention the work that Heinz Zurek, who is there, and hi, Heinz, is doing in the EU, and I wish him good luck, because I think there is for once a great opportunity for the EU also to get very much involved and develop instruments in this area. So how come? Is it just about grabbing revenue? And I don't think so. For sure, it has been one of the dimensions, but I think this has been marginal. I think what is at stake, and that's the point I want to make, I think the global tax challenge, the big challenge of tax in the globalization, is about regulation. I think the financial crisis in 2008-2009 has revealed a deep need for regulation. Financial regulation, and you can see the work which has been performed by the FSB, but also tax regulation. And I think that's why the G20 in two steps asked us, or responded to our proposal positively, to engage work in tax matters. The first part of it has been about bank secrecy, lifting bank secrecy. Bank secrecy could have been considered as a black hole in this international environment where people, high net worth individuals, could hide their assets from the taxman. And at the time where politicians, governments had to put trillions of dollars on the table to save the financial institutions, it was hard for the governments to accept that the financial institutions they were saving were part of a system where bank secrecy allowed taxpayers not to pay their taxes, taxes which were needed to save the international financial system. So you can see that it was easy to square the circle there and just say, well, we put an end to bank secrecy, we leverage on the work that the OECD had been doing for more than a decade, and we come to a point where we ask countries to make commitments. But beyond commitments, we put in place something a bit intrusive. And that was the first time, I think, that we were able to develop a peer review mechanism, which would result in rating countries, in doing lists, in telling countries where you're not good enough, you're not up to the standard that you have committed to. And I think the Global Forum, by bringing all the countries and jurisdictions on an equal footing, we now have more than one, I mean, we have exactly 123 members of the Global Forum, the most recent members being Peru and Niger. So it's very interesting to see that we are extending the membership to developing countries after having covered all G20, all OECD, and all financial centers. And we have a new dimension there, which is about tax regulation by having this peer review mechanism. That was the first step, which has also translated into developing new instruments. We had a multilateral convention on mutual assistance. This was developed in the 80s. This was poorly used, poorly signed in 2009, in 3 months' time. And you can see the speeding up the process there. In 3 months' time, we did a protocol which brought this convention up to the standard, which opened this convention to all the countries and all jurisdictions across the world, as before it was limited to OECD and Council of Europe countries. And as a result, we now have more than 85, I think, territories covered and many countries queuing to sign this multilateral convention, which is used as the legal basis to move towards the new standard, which is automatic exchange of information. In 5 years' time, we've moved from complete bank secrecy in many jurisdictions to an environment where not only do we have all the countries committed to exchange of information on request, but almost all the countries committed to implementing automatic exchange of information by 2017 and 2018, with only four jurisdictions not committed being Panama, Cook Islands, Vanuatu, and Bahrain. Quite anecdotal except for Panama, which is a big source of concern. All that to say that from 2007, where bank secrecy was the rule, to today, we've moved at a very quick pace and to a level of cooperation which is unprecedented. And beyond the cooperation, we have a mechanism to ensure that countries will implement and that they will be monitored by the international tax community, the Global Forum, the OECD, the G20. But this is not limited to this easy issue of bank secrecy. I say easy because when I remember my trips to Luxembourg or Switzerland or Singapore or Hong Kong, I can tell you, and you know it, that it was not as easy as it seems today. But we've moved to another critical part of the international tax structure, which are about the rules to eliminate double taxation, and as importantly, the lack of rules to organize or to bridge the gaps between sovereignties. We all know that tax is at the core of sovereignty and at the core of democracy when there is a democracy, because it's about the consent to tax. But as a result of that, countries have poorly cooperated, even on bank secrecy. They were not able to assist each other. Now we've reached a point, and that was the second step in the G20 mechanism, which appeared in June 2012 in Los Cabos, with a reference to the work that we had started. It was just an initial reflection from the Bureau of the Committee on Fiscal Affairs. And I would like to say hello to Manal Corwin, who I think is in the room. So hi, Manal. You will remember this Bureau meeting where we started talking about base erosion, profit shifting, the concerns of the member countries, and the fact that we had to work on that. Drawing on this discussion we had the new Bureau membership, we had the new director, I just started as director at Center for Tax Policy and Administration. Drawing on that, we proposed to the G20, or we floated the idea to the G20 in June 12, it was the Los Cabos meeting, that we could work on base erosion and profit shifting. And the G20 quickly afterwards said, well, we are very much interested in that. And we want you to work there because we have an issue. We have businesses which are global and countries which are local, which are based on their own sovereignty, and they don't cooperate much with each other. And as a result, it looks like we are losing a lot of money. And more importantly than the money, that's the same case as I did earlier for bank secrecy, more than losing money or being able to grab more money, we want to ensure a tax system which is more fair, and I'm quite reluctant to use that word because it's a bit confusing. It's not about multinationals not being fair because they would not contribute, but it's about the fairness of the overall tax system, where some who are not exempted by law are actually reducing their tax burden quite dramatically because of loopholes in international tax framework, which is developed by obscure technocrats in Paris. That's not fair. That's not the right thing to do. That's not the purpose of the international tax system. The parliaments could vote reduce corporate income tax for multinationals if you think that because they are mobile, they should benefit a more favorable treatment. But that has not been the case. The outcome was due to the lack of cooperation between countries, to the lack of relevance of the rules which had not been updated. In other words, the rules were there to limit the frictions between sovereignties marginally, while businesses had grown global. And as a result, they could use all the gaps between the sovereignties. And that's why I think the BEPS action plan, the base erosion profit shifting action plan that we developed at the request of the G20, became so successful, because countries realized that it was time for them to develop more regulation. So the BEPS action plan, I would see it as an increased regulation to make sure that we don't fall into the opposition or the contradiction to globalization, which would be protectionism. The very easy way to protect your tax base is precisely to establish protectionism, to move away from the rules that you think are no more relevant. So the BEPS action plan actually is about providing more regulation, but in a way which is more inclusive, with all countries agreeing this, including the big emerging countries. Because one of the big changes and one of the big challenges of the new global environment is that we've shifted from a G7 OECD traditional environment to a G20 new environment, G20 Global Forum, G20 OECD, G20 BEPS project, where all the G20 countries are on an equal footing. And as you will have seen, we are trying to bring more developing countries on an equal footing so that the global rules be globally relevant, or if they cannot be global, then we should identify what is specific for developing countries to address their own specific concerns. You know the logic of the BEPS action plan, three main pillars. The first one is about bridging the gaps between the sovereignties, establishing best practices for CFC, control foreign companies, developing rules for interest deductibility, neutralizing hybrid mismatches, as well as making some more progress on so-called harmful tax practices, even though this is quite marginal compared to what we did in the 90s, where this was the headline. The second pillar is about restoring the international instruments, the tax treaties, which were bilateral by nature, but actually were shopped quite aggressively, losing their relevance, and the transfer pricing rules. Was the arm's length principle developed in the 1920s to result with all the profit located in a cash box in Bermuda? The answer is no. That is not why this principle was developed. And if we don't recognize, acknowledge this, we're going to lose this principle. And we think that we should not lose this principle because there is no alternative. Something that from reapportionment is an alternative, we don't believe so, because there are even more problems with firm reapportionment, but we need to fix the arm's length principle. So fixing tax treaties, fixing the arm's length principle, that's the second pillar. The third pillar is about transparency. Transparency by multinationals, improving the reporting, and that's Section 13, country-by-country reporting, but also disclosing the aggressive tax schemes, and also in terms of transparency, better understanding what's going on, because we don't know. We're lacking data, and as a result, we don't have a good intelligence of globalization, of the way multinationals operate, and that's why we have Action 11. We have also some across-the-board action, one on the digital economy, and you will have seen the report we issued on this one, and finally, speeding up the implementation of all these through Action 15 and the development of a multilateral instrument, And last and certainly not least, if we eliminate double non-taxation, we should be good at eliminating double taxation. And I think we have a critical challenge ahead of us, which is to seriously, definitely improve the mutual agreement procedures. We're halfway. We've developed 7 out of the 15 measures. You know about them. I mean, revising the transfer pricing rules, even though this will be finalized only in 2015, putting a principle and a minimum standard of anti-treaty shopping, that's action 6, neutralizing hybrid mismatches. You've seen the report on the digital economy, which says that a ring-fence solution is not the right solution, but that BEPS is exacerbated in this area, and companies in this area have been probably over-aggressive compared to the others. And therefore, the solutions that we will bring through intangible treatment, I mean, the tax transfer pricing treatment of intangible property might facilitate the solution there. So digital economy being a separate report. And finally, the country-by-country reporting, where we have reached, I think, and it's a good illustration of what this project can do. Because then you have Brazil, India, South Africa, China, all the other G20 countries, all the OECD, G20 and non-OECD countries agreeing on the template. We could have had many FATCAs or equivalents of unilateral extraterritorial legislations asking for a country-by-country reporting, public, by the way, by many countries. Instead of that, we have had an agreement on only 6 elements of information to be included in a template, 6 columns, as many lines as you have countries where the multinational operate, with the principle of this information to be shared only with tax administrations through secured mechanism, tax treaties, and all the countries agreeing to implement this and only this. I can give you an example. I was in Delhi last Monday. I was in New Delhi for a tax seminar organized by the G20 team with the revenue authorities. Some business representatives were there. And interestingly, Akhilesh Ranjan, who's the Indian delegate, who's really good and really smart, said, in response to a question from the business community, we are going to implement all the action plan, but just the action plan. And he recognized that there were fears that India would move away. He said, no, we take it very seriously. I wish all the OECD member countries would take it as seriously as he does in terms of cooperating, in terms of committing to things and implementing them, which makes me think, and I will conclude with that, that one of the big challenges ahead of us is not only to conclude the BEPS action plan by the end of 15. I can tell you that it's real hard work. It's extremely complicated. But let's say it's easy. The real challenge will come post 15, where countries will have to implement their commitments, and where I think we will collectively have to monitor the implementation of the commitments. And when you step back and look at what was happening prior to the financial crisis, the OECD was good at developing rules, recommendations, and we didn't care whether the recommendations were implemented or not. We pretend that the arm's length principle is properly implemented, where actually we don't know. While tomorrow we'll move to an environment where we will monitor the implementation of the commitments taken by countries. So we are at a real juncture. It's extremely exciting, extremely challenging. I'm not in Ireland, but I speak in Ireland to an Irish audience. I should say, and I should have said, that Ireland has been part of this process, has been part of the discussion, has been extremely constructive, even though what is at stake in Ireland is pretty big, because you are a small open economy, which is extremely attractive from a tax perspective. You've taken some steps, and I know that these steps were criticized by some. From the OECD perspective, I can tell you that these steps are perceived as extremely smart. That's the right move. That's sending the right message, that aggressive tax planning, as it was practiced until recently, has come to an end. We need to move to an environment where tax competition will be a reality, will be very important, but will be based on other tools than providing loopholes in different tax systems, lack of cooperation. It will be much fairer to the extent that it will be based on broadening the base, reducing the rate, playing it straight. And I think Ireland will be best placed in that form of competition. Again, sorry not to be with you, not to be able to interact, to respond to your question, to sense the audience. Pretty frustrating to talk to this camera, which has not smiled, which has not laughed, which has not even complained. No, I wrote, but I hope you have. And I look forward to interacting with you further at another circumstance. Thank you very much.